Alright, let's do A star. Literally, like, 300 lines of code, but we'll get it done. Let's see what we can do. First thing, we'll go to our apps.js, and we'll add A star right here. It's an app, classes, utils, A star. And we will create the A star file, which is astar.js, and we'll put it in utils. And we will start. So we will define the class, and it's going to accept class, tile, and rectangle. We're going to do our function, and that's obviously going to have class, tile, and rectangle. Close our define statement, return a star, and set a star var a star is equal to class.extend. It's going to have the initialize function, and we are going to just leave this like so, and we're going to add all of the methods that are going to be used. So, first we have our constructor, which is the initialize. Then we have another one that we're going to be using. It's called find path. Then we will have trace path. Let me make sure. Okay. So we will have find path, then we'll have trace path. And let's also view our function list, which is right here. Oops. Can I just pull the function? Yeah, alright, let's put that over here on the right side. Bam. Alright, so we'll be able to see our functions as we're building them and navigate a little bit faster. Next, we're going to have isObstacle, or isObs, and that's a function. And then we will have our render. We'll have 2 pixels. Then we'll have 2 nodes. Then we'll have get size, update start, and update goal. So I believe these are all of the methods that will be attached inside of the class. Then we'll have one method that is static, a star and make sure. Yeah. And we'll have a star dot get currently finding. Set that equal to function. And we'll have some more static class, or some private functions here. So one's going to be function get heuristic. Then we will have get gcost. Oops, which is a function. Then we'll have function get f cost. And function get distance. Alright, I think this right here, as far as functions go, this is the full bare bones to the A-star class. Again, I'm doing little things wrong. I just need to actually define these as functions. Function. There we go. Now we can see all of our functions and we can work on these and get right to them over here in the navigator on the right. So again, that was just view function list. So the first thing we're going to do is come up here and define some private variables. So we'll say private bars. We have a handler. Gathering path. We'll set these on separate lines. Gathering path is equal to 0. Okay. So inside of the, we will add another one. Global grid, set that to a blank array. All right, so now we can come inside of our initializer, our constructor, and it's going to be taking a few variables: check time, handler, size, start, goal, and max path. Okay, so check time is specifically going to be for demoing kind of how it's working. So if we set check time to anything greater than 0, then we'll actually be able to watch the A-star pathfinding algorithm work and kind of pick out the path and find it. If it's set to 0, then it's going to run a bit differently and you won't actually, it won't render the progress and actually how it's finding the path. It's just going to find the path. That'll be set to 0 for like when we're done with it and we don't care to look at it running anymore. We just want it to work. So we're going to set our private variable handler. And that's going to be equal to the passed in handler. This dot size is going to be equal to the passed in size, which will be the size of the nodes. This dot entity is going to be equal to start. And this will be the reference to the parent. Parent entity. All right. Then this dot check time is going to be equal to check time. And again, it's the time in milliseconds between node checks. This dot width is equal to this dot two nodes, handler dot get world dot get width times tile dot tile width. In this will convert to the number of nodes wide the world is. So this will convert the width of the world in from pixels to nodes. That's what this two nodes function that we'll be building does. And it's really simple how it works, but it makes it easier to see what's going on when we just say use the two nodes function. This dot height is equal to this dot two nodes handler dot get world dot get height times tile dot tile height, and again number of nodes tall the world is. Then we have this dot closed list, and it's equal to an array, a blank array, and this will be an array of nodes that have been checked. This dot opened list is equal to a new array, and this is array of nodes to check. To check. And we'll have this dot path, and it's a new array, and it will be our array of waypoints or node positions in pixels to get from the goal to the start node. So this will actually be reversed. And then from here we also have if global nodes, global grid is not set, then we'll build the grid. So the difference between the global and the other grid that we'll be using is one is going to have all of the nodes in whether they are a solid object or anything like that in them all the time, and the other grid we'll be building privately for each instance of the A star class, where the other one is a global version. Alright, this dot grid is equal to global grid dot slice. And I think I'm doing dot slice so that it's not an instance or it's not a pointer to the global grid variable, but more a actual copy of the global grid set into a new variable. Max path is equal to underscore max path. And this will be the estimated longest path path in nodes. So this is how many nodes will the longest path be. So we won't know for sure, but you know, if we have 100 by 100 a 100 by 100 map diagonally from the top left to the bottom right, we might decide, 150 or something like that, 175 nodes in the longest path. I don't know. It's just what this will do is actually make it so that our pathfinding takes a lot less time, because it will be kind of like a little multiplier to kind of push the node checks toward where the goal is a little faster. And this is supposed to be global global grid. Okay. All right. So this, again, that's just going to, that max path is just going to help us find our goal and the path a little faster. Then we'll have this dot start is equal to, So this dot start is going to be equal to this dot goal, and that's going to be equal to a blank object. So starting goal, I keep bumping my trackpad on my laptop. Starting goal and starting and goal node object. This dot path found is equal to false, and this dot finding path is equal to false. This is everything we need in our constructor, so we can start our find path function. So let's begin. So if this dot finding path is not equal to true, then we will set finding path equal to true and gathering path, we will increment gathering path. I think gathering path, I think that this is in preparation for having multiple entities. I think that's what I was doing. I think so. All right, so underneath this, we'll say this dot path found is equal to false. And we'll say if this dot opened list dot length is greater than 0. So and this is make sure there are nodes in the opened list. So if it's greater than 0, this is what we will do. We're going to order the opened list so nodes with the lowest F cost are first. So we're going to, are first. No, not first child. There we go. So this dot opened list is equal to this dot opened list dot sort. And this function is going to sort them by F cost. And we will be at, you'll see once we start adding these values what is going on. So this is just to sort them. If A dot F cost is less than B dot F cost, return -1, else return 1. So we're just reordering these. And we'll close our sort function there. And we'll say we will now keep only nodes that have the same F cost as the lowest F cost. So now we're only going to keep the nodes that are equal to the lowest F cost. And we'll be gathering F cost with some functions and stuff in the future. So var opened is equal to this dot opened list. Var lowest is equal to this dot opened list dot filter. And we're just going to say return obj.fcost is equal to opened fcost. So we're only going to keep ones that are equal to the first fcost, which will be the lowest because we're sorting them by fcost up here. And fcost, if you go back to the A*STAR tutorial, our overview video, you'll see what the fcost is actually calculated to be. Next, we will order all the nodes remaining from lowest heuristic. So now we're going to order by lowest heuristic. So lowest is equal to lowests dot sort function, and we're doing A and B again, and in here we'll say if A dot heuristic, which is just her, B dot her, return -1, or else return 1. So now what we're doing is we are going to, if we have nodes that we've pushed into the open list, then we're going to sort them by fcost, only grab any nodes that have the same fcost as the lowest fcost node. Then we're going to take those and sort them in order from lowest to highest based on their heuristic. Again, you can see what the heuristic is in the A*STAR overview. So now we will set the current node to the node with the lowest fcost and heuristic. And that's simple enough. We'll say var current is equal to lowest at position 0. Because we've ordered them prior. So the one at the index of 0 is always going to have the lowest. All right. So now remove the current node from the opened list and put it into the closed list. And that is this dot opened list dot splice this dot opened list dot index of current. And we're just going to splice one index out. And then we will say this dot closed list dot push current. So we have just removed the node we're working with from the open list and added it to the closed list. All right, the next job to do is check if the current node is not the goal node, calculate the gcost and fcost for all the neighbor nodes. So now is going to be some for loops. So we'll say if current.x is not equal to this.goal.x or current.y is not equal to this.goal.y. So if it's not equal to the x and the y, essentially, then we'll do these for loops. So we'll say loop through all of the neighbor nodes around the current node. How that will work, we'll say for var I is equal to current dot x minus 1, I is less than or equal to current x plus 1, I plus plus. So what this does is this will get wherever the current x is of this node, or the current position of the node, we will go over to the left one node, and then we will loop over to the right one node. So we'll actually get the kitty corner node all the way to the other kitty corner node for the first loop. So you'll see how it's going with this next loop as well. So j is equal to current dot y minus 1. J is less than or equal to current dot y plus 1. And then it will be j plus plus. All right, so if I is greater than or equal to 0, and so this means that we're not going to check if, you know, we are at the very top left node, I is going to be, or let's say our current dot x is 0, if we say current dot x minus 1 will be negative 1. If we're at node 0, we'll be negative 1. And we don't have a negative 1 node to check. So there's no point in even doing it. We'll skip that loop, part of the loop. So then I is less than or equal to this dot width. So we need to make sure we are not in the negative numbers, and we're also not greater than the total width in or the total amount of nodes in the map. So also, if j is greater than or equal to 0 and j is less than or equal to this dot height. So we're first checking, that's what this if statement is checking, to make sure we're within the bounds of the map. All right, so set the local neighbor to the current neighbor we are checking. So if, oh, and that needs to go, this if right here. We're also going to check if this dot grid I j exists. So we need to make sure that the node exists in the grid, and we'll be building that grid with the build grid function that we call up here, right here. So you'll see how that grid's going to be built and what it's going to look like. So then var neighbor is equal to we're going to make it an object where x is equal to I. So this is position on x in nodes, and then y, which is j, and that's the position on y in nodes. Then obs, whether it's an obstacle, we'll say this dot is obs, passing in I and j. So what this function is going to do is check to see if this node is an obstacle, because if it's an obstacle, we're not even going to check it, we'll actually skip by it. So this is a boolean whether node is an obstacle. I don't know how to spell that, or not. Parent is null. Reference to the node which the character should come from. To get to this node. So right now it's going to be set to null, but we'll actually set the parent to the node that this node you would come from to get to this node for the path. And we can actually reassign these parent nodes based on if we find a faster or, you know, a quicker path to get to that node as well. Gcost we'll set to 0. This distance, this is the distance traveled to get to that node from the start node. So this will be the distance to get to here from the start node. And F cost is going to be 0 to start, and that this is the G cost plus heuristic, which will weigh the node for sorting when finding the path. All right, so this will actually build the object that we'll use as the neighbor node. And that will be used for calculations in a moment. So this dot grid at position I, J is going to be set to the neighbor that we just created. Alright, so that's if that one doesn't exist already. Else, if it does exist, we'll say neighbor is equal to this dot grid at I, J, because it'll already have been set. No need resetting the neighbor if it already has values in it. All right. Else, right here, we'll say get heuristic requires a node object. This is why it cannot be within the object. Object declaration. So we need to actually have an object set before we can calculate the heuristic. So we're going to assign the heuristic right here to the neighbor. So we'll say, because it's relative, so or because we'll be calculating it right now. So neighbor dot heuristic is equal to get heuristic, and we're going to pass in this neighbor and this dot goal and this dot max path. So the calculating the heuristic will take these three properties. So we will create that function once we're done here. And the heuristic essentially is the distance to the goal node. All right. So now we need to make sure the neighbor is, make sure the neighbor is not the current node. We don't want to check it against itself. We need to make sure the neighbor is not an obstacle. Whatever. And then we also need to make sure the neighbor is not in the closed list. So these are some checks that we need to make sure. And that will look like this. If neighbor is not equal to current, and neighbor dot obstacle is equal to false, and this dot closed list dot index of neighbor equals equals negative one. So if all three of those conditions are met, we can continue on. And we will calculate the G cost of the current neighbor. So to do that, we'll say var G cost is equal to get G cost current and neighbor. So this will calculate the basically what it will cost to go from the current node to this neighbor, and that is usually it's usually whether it's, you know, cost one unit to go from this current node to the right would be one, or up or down or to the left would be one, but at an angle would be like 1.4 or something like that. Again, that's explained in the A-star overview video. Next, check if the neighbor is already in the open list. So we say if this dot opened list dot index of neighbor is not equal to negative one, then we will be doing some stuff inside of here if it already exists. So what's going to happen is we will say if the neighbor is in the opened list, calculate the new F cost from the current, you know, the one from this current node to, or sorry, the new F cost if it were to come from this current node. Alright, so basically if the neighbor is in the open list, calculate the new F cost. And see if it's less than the neighbor's current F cost. So if the neighbor is already in the open list, we then want to check to see if coming from this current node is going to yield a smaller F cost than coming from whatever node the neighbor node has as a parent currently. So we'll say if neighbor dot F cost is greater than G cost plus neighbor dot heuristic, because that's how you calculate F cost, is the G cost plus the heuristic. So if the current F cost is greater than what the current F cost will be, since the F cost is less, we will say the neighbor dot parent is going to be reset to the current parent, or so the current node. So reset the parent to the current node, neighbor dot g cost will be reset to the current g cost we calculated up on 87. Reset g cost and neighbor.fcost we will recalculate by fcost, which will be a function that takes in a node, and reset fcost. All right, else, so we're going to say else if it isn't in the open list, else since the neighbor is not in the opened list, we will say this.openedList.pushNeighbor. So we will add the neighbor to the opened list, and we will set neighbor.parent is equal to current, because it didn't currently have a parent anyways, so we were not resetting anything, we're actually setting it for the first time since it's not in the open list. So we will set the parent of the neighbor node to the current node, neighbor.gcost is equal to gcost, set to the gcost, neighbor.fcost is equal to getfcost neighbor, set the fcost. And this should end if in open list. This should end if not current obstacle closed list. So if it's not any of these three things, that's what that if statement is. And this will be end for J. End for I. Then the next, the last thing to do here, we'll say if this.check time is greater than 0. So that means if we want to kind of slow down this process, then we will say var t is equal to this, because we're going to be going diving inside of a function, so this won't refer to our main A star class. It will refer to what's inside of the anonymous function. So we will be set, we will set a temporary reference to this for use in the anonymous function. So we will create a timeout for the amount of time passed in the constructor. So that check time, we will now use that to create a set time out. And in here, we will just say t.find path, which will just rerun the find path function at the set timing. So that's what this does here, is it just delays that. So, and then we just pass in this.check time. So whatever time is passed into the constructor, that's how long we'll wait before we run the function again. Else, if the check time is basically 0, then we will just say this dot find path, so we call it immediately. All right, now this else statement, this will be else this node is the goal node. So if this is the goal node, then we're done, and we're just going to run a different function, this.tracePath, passing in the current node, and that current node is going to have a parent, and each parent is going to have its own parent until we get all the way back to the starting node. So essentially, once you have the current node being the goal, we can just trace the parents back all the way to the starting node, which gives us a path for our player in this case. All right. The next thing is trace path. Else, in this else is else there is no nodes in the opened list. There was no path found to the goal node. So let's find the next closest node. So this dot closed list dot sort function a b, and what we're going to do is order the closed list ascending by heuristic. So if a dot heuristic is less than b dot heuristic, return -1, else return 1. Then we will do the same thing, this.tracePath, and we will just pass in this.closedList at position 0. So pass the closest node to the goal node in as the node to trace from. So this will be the node to trace back to our starting node from. And we will end the find path function here. All right, so that was a lot of stuff going on, but good news is it seems to be done right. All of our open and closed brackets are good. It kind of goes over what each part does. We're essentially just looping through all the neighbors, assigning the values, and checking to see if the values need to be updated based on the current node that we're at. So now the trace path function, this will reset all variables related to finding the path. This dot path is equal to new path this dot grid is equal to new array. Oops, this should be array as well. This dot path found is going to be set to true. So set path found to true. This variable is for the rendering function. So this variable specifically for if we decide to render based on if the path is found. var current is equal to node that was passed in. Set the local current node to the node passed. Oh my gosh. To the current node passed into the function. So the reason we are doing this is because we're actually going to call this function passing in different nodes each time. Node. Or actually we won't, we'll be doing a while loop right under here. So we'll say while current.x is not equal to this.start.x or current.y is not equal to this.start.y. So what we're basically saying is while the current node is not the start node. And what we'll end up doing in here is saying current.isPath is equal to true. Set is path to true, letting the renderer know this node is part of the path. So we may not even use this in the rendering, but we may do it. It depends on the way I want to go with it. So this.path.push x is equal to this.toPixels current.x, and y is going to be equal to this.toPixels current.y. What did I do over here? I did not close that. Or this one. Alright. So what we've just did is we're getting a x and a y in nodes, and we want to create an array of positions in pixels. So that's what we are doing. So we will push the node position in pixels into the path array. All right, and then current is equal to current.parent. So we will reset the current node to the parent of the current node. And this dot finding path is equal to false. So what we're doing is we're using a while loop and just pushing the current node into our paths array, then updating the current node to whatever the parent of the current node is until this becomes a true statement or a false statement, meaning that we are at the goal node and we will not be pushing that node into the paths array. And instead, we'll continue on with our function. We'll say gathering path minus minus. All right, this dot entity dot set path, which I think we have that function. If not, we'll be making it. set path, and it's going to be equal to this.path.reverse. So we're going to take the array and reverse it. So set the entities path array equal to the reverse of the path array created. Path array we created. And then from here we will just be resetting this.openedList is equal to a new array, and this.closedList is equal to a new array. So array of nodes to check, and array of nodes that have been checked, just so we remember. And this will end the trace path function. So now the core of what makes this work is done, all the logic. We just need to start filling out some of these other functions that we used in there. So the first one is to check if the node is over top of or intersecting a object or an obstacle. So to do that, we will take an X and a Y, and we will create a range of tiles that the node is overlapping. So var start X is equal to math.max 0 parse int this.2pixels X divided by tile.tile width. So this should look familiar. It's essentially the same thing we're doing in our display or our camera or whatever, so that we only render pixel or only render tiles that we see. Instead, we're only going to render tiles or loop through tiles that are intersecting the node. Start y is equal to math.max 0 or parse int this.2pixels y divided by tile.tile height. Var end x is equal to math.min parse int this dot, or sorry, handler dot get world dot get width, or parse int this dot 2 pixels x plus this dot size divided by tile.tile width. And var and y is equal to math.min and that will be parse int handler.getWorld. Oops, this needs to be a function. Dot get height parse int this dot 2 pixels y plus this dot size divided by tile dot tile height. So now we have a start and an end range to loop through. So now we can loop through all of the tiles and check if any of them are solid tiles. So So 4 var I is equal to start X. I is less than or equal to end X. I plus plus. Then 4 var J is equal to start Y. J is less than or equal to end Y. J plus plus. And we'll say if handler.getWorld.getTile, passing in I and J, dot is solid. So if it is solid, which we use that function already, we will return true. We will also check if it overlaps a static entity like a tree or something. So check if node overlaps a static entity. Get a list of only static entities. Var entities is equal to handler.getWorld.getEntity. Get entity manager.getEntities. Say, now we can check if any of the static entities are intersecting the node. Intersecting. The node. So, for var e is equal to 0, e is less than entities.length, e plus plus. Var ent is equal to entities at position e. And then if entity is not equal to this dot entity, so we'll make sure not to count the current entity. And if entity dot is static, so set local entity to the entity at index of E. So that's what we did up there. All right. Now we'll just create two rectangles and use the intersect function for that. So var entity box is equal to new rectangle entity.x plus entity.bounds.x entity y plus ent.bounds.y, and then it will have a width of entity.bounds.width and a height of entity.bounds.height. And then the checkbox, so the box that is going to be the current node, essentially. It will be a new rectangle, and this would be this dot 2 pixels x, this dot 2 pixels y, and this dot size by this dot size. So we've created two rectangles, and their positions are in pixels. So we can say if the two rectangles are intersecting, then return true. So if entbox.intersects checkbox return true. And if none of them run, return false, meaning it is not an obstacle. So if the node doesn't overlap a solid tile or a static entity, then return false. And this will end isObs function. Alright. So we will skip our render for now and go straight to our two pixels. And this is going to be very simple. It's going to take in a value, and it's going to return value times this dot size. Inversely, two nodes is going to take a value and return parse int the value divided by this dot size. And for anything that wants to get the current node size, we can return this dot size. Alright, so to update the starting node, we will just say var x is equal to this dot two nodes x. So we will pass in, we will pass in x and y into here. And var y is equal to this dot two nodes y. And the next thing is then to create the this dot start node. And that's going to be equal to an object that we fill out. So x is going to be equal to x, y is equal to y, obs is equal to this dot is obs, passing in x and y. Then parent is null. And gcost is 0. And fcost is 0. Okay. So that is a boolean. And we know what these are. I'll just throw some comments in there. All right, and then under this, we will actually push it into the open list. So this dot opened list dot is equal to new array this dot start. So we are pushing that, or we are setting it equal to a new array with this as the first node. All right, now we will update the goal node. Very similar to the point where we will copy everything in here, paste it in there. And the only difference is up here, I'll actually say var obs is equal to this dot is obs, passing in x and y. Because we're going to check to see if they clicked on an obstacle. So then we can just say if obs is false, meaning we are good to go, it was not it was not a obstacle that they clicked on, then this dot end, and we will not push it in to the open list, of course. So there you are. These should be both of those functions. And we can say return gathering path. So if we want to get whether it's currently finding or not, maybe if we set a timeout and we don't want them to be able to click anymore until it's done finding the path, then we can check to see if it's gathering the path before we do any other actions. All right, so here we can start getting some of those functions done. So the heuristic returns the distance in nodes from the node to the goal node. And it's going to take a node and a goal. So if max path equals 0, return get distance node in goal, and we'll create that function in a moment. Else, if we have a max path set, so how many nodes we think the longest path will consist of, we're going to do a little bit of a hack to the math so that the A star pathfinding algorithm will kind of skew in more of an egg shape when trying to find a path, so that it but let's say it'll just try to wander closer to the goal node faster without worrying about nodes that don't really get it there. So instead of, you know, spanning out in a circle, it's going to span out at a real skewed long oval-ish shape. And you'll see once we render these what I'm talking about. But yeah, it's going to want to go toward the goal node faster than it tries checking any paths that, you know, are further from the goal node. So that will look like this. Return get distance node goal, so the distance, and we'll times it by 1 plus 10 divided by max path. So this little bitty change right here actually will cause, you know, something that what would have taken potentially 1,000 checks, node checks, could take only, you know, 100 node checks or even less, just because it's so geared, especially if it's a straight path or something. With just a few things in the way, it will extremely fix or optimize how many checks it takes to find the goal. Next is the G cost. So returns the total distance traveled from start node to node 2. So node 1 in node 2. So return node 1.gcost plus get distance between node 1 and node 2. And this just will build up for each node the distance that has been traveled to get to it. Right? And then the F cost, return the F cost, which is G cost plus heuristic. And that takes a node. And that will say return node.gcost plus node.heuristic. And here's our get distance, A and B. Var dist x is equal to a dot x minus b dot x. Var dist y is equal to a dot y minus b dot y. And return math dot round math dot square root dist x times dist x plus dist y times dist y times that by 10. So we're dealing with some round big numbers. Alright, and I believe this is the entire class without the rendering function. So we can, let's add some rendering in here. I'm thinking that what I'll do is just kind of grab the rendering that I'm using and quickly go over it, because it's a lot of the same stuff that we've done in the past. It's not anything special really. So I will just grab render and I will paste it in here. So we're passing in obviously the graphics object. So we're saying if this dot path found is false, then we'll loop through the closed list, and we're going to loop through the closed list and fill red squares. Alright, so anything that's in the closed list will be rendered as a red square. Anything in the open list will be rendered as a gray square. And if the path has been found, then we will render white squares where the path has been found. Then this is just some stuff that goes in the top left that kind of shows how many checks we've been doing. So that is the rendering function. So the next thing to do is add this to the player. So player now is going to also take the A star, and A star. We're going to throw this under our health bar here. This dot A star is equal to new A star. Come on, why do I keep doing that? A star. And we will pass in, let's say, 500 milliseconds for our time check so that we can slow it down and see what's going on. Pass in the handler, math dot max. This dot bounds dot, you know what, let's just do it like this. We will say each one is this dot height plus 30, mostly plus 40. We'll see how that looks. That's the size of the nodes. And this will be the start node. And what else does A star take? It'll take a start node and a goal node. So we can just pass this in for both to start. And then we will say the max path size is 100 for now. Okay, the next thing that we want to do is we will render it. So, and we'll render it above, before everything. So this dot A star dot render. Okay, so right now we are currently pushing in waypoints. Do I have a set path? I don't. So what we'll do is we'll just create that new function. Right underneath before follow path, we'll say set path. and that's going to be equal to a function that takes in a path array. And it's going to be simple. All it does is this dot path is equal to the path that was passed in. We will get rid of this here. And we'll say this dot a star, this dot a star dot update start is going to be this dot x plus this dot width divided by 2 and this dot y plus this dot height divided by 2. So we're resetting the starting node as the player's x and y, and then this dot a star dot update goal is equal to pose dot x, which I removed. Here we are. There we go. So we'll just be using those values. So we're adding to it, obviously, the offset of the camera. All right. A star update goal is, oh, and we still want to keep, we want to create a mouse, basically like a little box that represents where the mouse is so that we know where it's overlapping. We're gonna put this stuff outside of the right click because we will use this anytime it's clicked. All right, inside of here we'll use pose x and pose y dot y, and then we will say this dot a star dot find path. Because we've updated the start node, which will put a node in the open list, it should begin running. All right, that should be all that's necessary. Let's see how many things need to be fixed. Player line 72. Let's see. We need the comma there. Health bar is not defined on 39. Health bar probably would help if I put commas. Okay, and let's see what happens when we click. Uncaught reference rectangle is not defined in player. So I have to include rectangle. Rectangle. And rectangle. Let's make sure in my graphic shapes I have my intersects. Yep. Okay. Handler.getWorld in A star on line 169. Oh, A star. 169. Entities handler.getWorld. Dot get entity manager is a function. Is static. Entity dot is static. So that needs to be in the static entities. We need to say this dot is static is equal to true, else by default every creature, we will say this dot is static is equal to false. Entity dot is static 175. Let's make sure entity manager has get entities. Yes. Okay. A star on 175 is entity dot is static. So let me console dot log entity. Okay, so we do have an entity is static is not just a variable, but it is a function. That's why. So is static is considered a function here. That's what I should have did. So in the creature, we will take is static from here. Go into our entity class, create a new getter, and it will be called isStatic, and that's a function that by default returns false. Copy this. Go into our static entities, remove that from here, and just say is static is equal to true. So for any static entities, it will be set to true. And endbox.intersect is not a function. And that is on 179. Intersects rectangle intersects. There we go. It isn't a function. All right, underscore x is not defined in 239. So we've got something happened. All right, we didn't even pass in an x and a y here. X and y. And lowest is not defined, so we've got a few things that I missed, but that's fine. We're cranking through them. 43. Lowests. I just did not save that. I did not set it with an S at the end. Okay. And cannot define property 0 of undefined on 61. Zero of undefined. Did I not create the build grid function? I don't remember creating the build grid. Let me see. Build grid. I actually don't have build grid in here. So So what do I do? Let me see what I'm doing. Ah, I missed one line. I don't need to build grid, that's why I don't. Right above here, I need to do a check. And if it doesn't exist, we will add it. So what we're basically saying is if grid at index I it doesn't exist, we're just going to set it to a blank array. All right. And then max path is not defined on 94. I think that's because it needs to be this.maxPath. Or wait, that needs to be in the function. M for get heuristic, max path needs to be set. See a lot of little things that I did wrong. Okay, probably the same problem. Property x undefined. Property x of undefined, line 55. So current dot x. Where do I set current? Do I set current? Did I miss setting current? Nope, current is set right here. Lowest's 0. Okay. Let's console.log lowest's. Fcost obstacles false, parent is null, so it is, but then it's not set. We're not pushing anything. Current is then set to nothing. So it loops through it one time. Pushed it. Okay, so the open list, we're splicing it out. We're pushing it into the closed list. First time it goes through, that's right. We need to push a neighbor into the opened list. So we need to make sure that current.x. Okay, so I'm going to remove the console log. So someplace in here, we aren't checking the other nodes. Actually, now that I think about it, this node shouldn't be red, and it definitely shouldn't be on top. Let's see. F is not equal to goal.y. We're good. Loop through all neighbors. Let's see if I can find this real quick and just fix this error, and we'll move on to any other. All right, I think the final problem is down here. I actually said this.end, and it's supposed to be this.goal. So now if we refresh this and we run and we click, so grays are opens, and the reds are in the closed list. So I don't even think we can get over here. Oh, yep, we can. Okay, if we come over here, we can go between the trees, it shows, but it's skipping around the trees. Here we go. So it's going around, it's trying to find the path. Bam. And it's rendering the paths. So you can see how many checks it takes. It's 5, 6, 7. So, and it also looks like it's taking a while, but that's just because we've set in our player, we set it to take 500 milliseconds. So if we take this down to, let's say 20 milliseconds, we should still see it render, but yet it'll be a lot faster. Let me find a spot. So one thing I could say, the blocks are a little big. So we can take this 40 and put it down to like 20. A little bit smaller now. So now you can see it's gonna walk between the trees, but not through the trees, but behind the tree. So it took this path probably because it doesn't think it can go through this area. Yeah. Yeah, this spot right here is too small. This basically acts like these are two blocked off pieces. So we either need to change our map or lower the size of our grid for the A star. There it goes. Now it can fit in there. So we can come over here. So one thing about the A star is collisions with static entities are kind of not really necessary anymore, because this isn't going to lead you, it's not going to let you touch a static entity. They treat static entities as if they are obstacles that you can't get through. So now we have A star working. So one thing I'll show you now that we've got it done, I'll go over to this one right here. This is a bigger map. It's the same thing. It's just a bigger map, and I've got my mini map going that we'll be using. So you can see we're all the way up here in the corner. Let's say I pick over here. You can see he finds his way through this entire map, and I've got the camera kind of focusing on him. So he's gonna find his way all the way over there. This is A star, guys, and it's working. It may not be the best implementation. I'm not 100% sure. You know, there's probably tons of optimization I can do. Maybe even calculating the distance could be done faster instead of using square root. There's a lot of other things. But for the general idea, you can see that this works. So the next thing that I also want to do is maybe get this mini map working for you guys so you can have a mini map as well. It was pretty simple. Actually, like much simpler than I thought it would be. All right, so it looks like we have A star working. Also, I'm probably gonna have a tutorial where I just essentially have a picture that I made in Paint. This right here, and I'm using JavaScript in a separate project to convert this into a map. That we can use so that you can kind of just draw your map out much faster. Right now I'm just using black and white, but eventually I'll be able to use all different colors to represent different types of tiles. So yeah, so right now this is all that we've got going. This is A star, and we've got ours working with, you know, all of our stuff rendering our little grid for our spatial grid for collisions. And you see how they kind of they run independent of each other. So I can turn off my spatial grid, I could remove collision detection, and everything will still run just without those things. So yeah, it's working. It's looking good. Yeah, that's A-Star, guys. And really, it's not as long as I thought it would be to get it working. Again, if you have any questions about exactly what is going on in the implementation that I have, I did create that A-Star pathfinding tutorial that kind of showed what I was going to do and how the heuristic works and all that. But yeah, cool beans, guys. Let me know what you think. I'm excited that I got this out. I've been wanting to do it for a while. I just was having a lot of problems. And I think that this method should do fine for a simple game. I won't have hundreds of entities out on the screen. And we'll come up with some reason to have A-Star. Because, I mean, we've got to have an actual reason to do that. So maybe we'll do something where you can kind of set a few players off to do some sort of task, so you could like click on something and tell them to go do a certain task. Maybe we'll think of it. Alright guys, thanks for watching, and I'd love to hear some feedback, and if anybody has like some optimizations for this A-Star implementation, even if your criticism is it sucks, I mean, at least it's something. And maybe you could help me and figure out where I could, you know, strip the fat off of this. I will see you guys in another tutorial.